In this segment, we're going to continue our discussion on uniqueness of interpolating polynomial. And we're at this particular phase, which I said that, hey, what I want to be able to show is that if R2x has three zeros, if a second order interpolating polynomial has three zeros, then R2 of x is identically equal to zero. So let's go and see that how that can be proved. So if you have a second order polynomial, it has three zeros, then R2 of x is identically equal to zero. That means R2 of x, for example, let's suppose I assume R2 of x to be a second order polynomial, which is like this. Okay. And I know that it has three zeros, so that means that it has three zeros at x0, x1, and x2. So R2 of x0 is zero. R2 of x1 is equal to 0, and R2 of x2 is equal to 0. That's what we showed last time, is that you have, in the last segment, that you have three zeros, one at x0, one at x1, and one at x2. So if I write down this as an equation, that means that a0 plus a1 x0 plus a2 x0 square has to be 0, because we know that R2 of x0 is equal to 0. Then same thing, R2 at x1 is 0. But that can be written as a0 plus a1 x1 plus a2 x1 square is equal to 0. We also know that R2 at x2 is 0, so that's a0 plus a1 x2 plus a2 x2 square is equal to 0. So basically what we have is we have three zeros of R2 at x0, x1, and x2, so we can set up these three equations and three unknowns there. So once we have the three unknowns, which are a0, a1, and a2, let's go and write this in a matrix form, so that will make it a little bit clearer what we are trying to look for and how we can show that R2 of x is identically equal to 0. So the unknowns are a0, a1, and a2, and the coefficient matrix looks like this, 1, x1, x1 square, 1, x2, x2 square, and 0, 0, 0. You can right away see that a trivial solution for this one, the trivial solution for this one is that A1, A0, A1, and A2 are all 0. So the solution vector is a 0 vector, because if I put A0, A1, and A2 equal to 0, I'll get 0 equal to 0. But this does not prove that R2 of x is equal to 0, that it's identically equal to 0, because I have to show that this trivial solution is the only solution. And the way I can show that trivial solution is the only solution is by showing that, hey, that this particular matrix here is invertible, or what they call as non-singular. So I need to show that this particular coefficient matrix is invertible or non-singular. Only if I'm able to show that it's invertible or non-singular can I say that, hey, the trivial solution is the only solution. Because if the coefficient matrix is invertible or non-singular, then we know that it is a unique solution. Since we have already found out one solution, that means that will be the only solution. So how do I go about doing that is by finding the determinant of this matrix. And I'm going to leave this as homework here. The determinant of this matrix, 1 x0, x0 square, 1 x1, x1 square, and 1 x2, x2 square. The determinant of this will turn out to be x1 minus x0 times x2 minus x1. Times x3 minus x2. That's what the determinant will turn out to be. And I will leave this as homework. I'm going to give you a few hints in a little bit for how to do this. So, but this is what turns out the determinant of this equation. And since we know that x1 is not same as x0, because you cannot have two identical x values when you're doing interpolation, same thing, x2 is not same as x1, and x3 is not same as x2, so this means it's not equal to 0. I mean, the determinant of a coefficient matrix is not equal to 0, that automatically proves that this particular coefficient matrix is non-singular or is invertible. So what that means is that we have shown that R2 of x is identically equal to 0, because a0, a1, and a2 is the only solution, and that is 0, 0, 0, and so R2 of x is identically equal to 0. Now, somebody might say, hey, can you show me how I can go about finding this determinant equal to this quantity here? All you have to do is, let me show you some of the hints. You follow the forward elimination steps of Gaussian elimination. That's what you need to do. You need to follow the forward relation steps of Gauss elimination, of Navier-Gauss elimination. And then once whatever you have at the end of forward elimination, you will get what? You will get an upper triangular matrix. So once you get an upper triangular matrix, you know that the determinant of an upper triangular matrix is the same as the multiplication of the diagonal elements. So basically you're using two theorems of determinants to be able to do that. So the theorem one is basically you're saying that if a multiple of a row is added or subtracted from another row of a n by n matrix, its determinant does not change. So that's the first theorem which you're using. So that's when you follow the forward elimination steps, you basically what you're doing is you're adding, you're subtracting multiple of one row from another. So the determinant of the original matrix is not going to change once you go through the forward elimination step process of Navier-Gauss method. The second theorem which you are using is that an upper triangular matrix, so for an upper triangular matrix, A, which is an n by n matrix, the determinant of A is nothing but A11 star, A22 star, all the way up to ANN, which is simply the multiplication of all the diagonal elements. Because that's what you're going to get at the end of the steps of the forward elimination of the Gauss elimination. So those two theorems you can apply, and you'll be able to see that that the determinant of the matrix will turn out to be what I showed you in the previous on the previous board. Now, some of the things which I want to mention here is that, let's suppose somebody gives you this, some confusion which or myths which students might develop. So let's suppose if you have somebody gives you three data points, 3, 4, 5, 82, and 9, 214. And you might be, somebody say, hey, go ahead and find the second order polynomial which goes through those three data points. And you get something like this, y is equal to 2x squared plus 5x plus 7. And that's by the direct method. If you use Lagrange interpolation, you'll get 10 divided by 3, x minus 5, x minus 9, minus 41 by 4, x minus 3, x minus 9. Plus 107 by 12, x minus 3, x minus 5. If you use, so that's from Lagrange interpolation. So if you use Lagrange interpolation, that's what you're going to get. If you use Newton's divided difference polynomial, this is what you're going to get, 40 plus 21 times x minus 3 plus 2 times x minus 3 and x minus 5. So this is the Newton's divided difference polynomial method. So what you're getting is for the same three data points, you're getting this particular polynomial by using the direct method, this particular polynomial by using the Lagrange method, and this particular polynomial by using the Newton's divided difference method. So it might give a false impression that you are getting three different polynomials by using these three different methods. That's not the case. This polynomial is exactly the same as this polynomial, is exactly the same as this polynomial. The only difference is the form of the polynomials which are being exhibited are different. So that's something which you do need to understand. Somebody's giving you three data points and you're able to find a second order polynomial which goes through those three data points. They're polynomials which you're going to get from any other polynomial interpolation method of order two or less, which is, in this case, this is by Lagrange method and this is by Newton's divided difference polynomial method. They are exactly the same. And that's the end of this segment.